Good afternoon, everybody. There must be a few people away. Yeah, there certainly are. But you're here, and that's good enough. Pardon me. The first part, part one, in a series of four. People say sometimes, how do you even know there was a Jesus? And if there was somebody by that name that seems to respond to some of the criteria, how do you know he said that he was whom he said he was? What evidence would you rely on? You understand? And even if you are willing to believe, there are doubts, aren't there? There are doubts that at times just creep in. Now, I hope to help you this afternoon. The title Desire of Ages, as such you don't find in the Bible, but you know who we mean. Who is the Desire of Ages? Jesus. Yes, absolutely, it's Jesus. The closest to it, and probably equal to it, is from Haggai, the second chapter, verse 7, where God says, when Haggai, he's pushing the people to build the second temple. Because the second temple is essential for the very being of the Jewish nation. Without the temple, forget it. Forget it. And so he makes the promises amongst all opposition to build this temple. He said, I will shake the nations, and the desire of all nations shall come. Now, when we talk about the desire of ages, we're talking about people that live throughout the ages. You understand that? When we talk about the desire of nations, nations are people. So the same thing. It's really desire for people of all nations, of all time, because they need that one to come. And I will fill this house with glory, says whom? The Lord of hosts. So, who will shake the nations? The Lord of hosts. The desire of all nations has to be the Lord of hosts as well, because I will fill this house with glory is qualified here that the desire of all nations shall come. Do you understand? And he shall come to the temple. There were people there old enough. There must have been old, 70 plus. That's old. And they looked at the rebuilt temple, and it was nothing like the Solomonic temple as far as grandeur and glory was concerned. And what the Lord is saying, he said, don't worry, I will come to this temple as the desire of ages, as the desire of nations. It means he is going to come in person. And you have here a certain prediction of the incarnation of the Lord of hosts. The one who is speaking here is the one who came. God in humanity. It's the same person. Now, the empirical evidence. What is empirical evidence? Well, it's information. Primarily, it's based on the senses. What you can see, what you can hear, what you can smell, what you can touch, what you can taste. But secondary to that, and not least less important, is other evidence. Reports, oral verbal reports. And certainly, prophecies. I'll have a look at this in a minute. The empirical evidence is information that justifies a belief. If you know what you believe, why you believe what you believe, that's great. You know why? Because then you can share with others. If you're not sure, how are you going to pass it on? And so it justifies a belief, or adversely, it can reject that belief. That is true too. It can reject that. Now, objective evidence is one portion of the evidence. We're going to deal with objective evidence mainly today. So objective evidence is important because that you can pass on. You understand, someone asks you, why do you believe in Jesus Christ? You could say, well, I pray to him. He hears my prayer. He makes all the difference in my life. I feel his presence. That is subjective, you understand. That means nothing to somebody who doesn't have that relationship. They look at you as if you're not quite well sometimes. No, they do. They do. Absolutely do. And sometimes they can become very aggressive about it too. Objective evidence. Such as historical evidence. History as we know it. History as we can agree on. So we have an historical evidence that certainly is objective. Connected with the historical evidence is the prophetic evidence. If you look at those two, if you look at the prophecies and the history as we know it, we have an enormous treasure house. And we will be unfolding the best of it in the next few presentations to come. And then, of course, we have the experiential. That is basically what you experience, and that, of course, is relatively subjective. Are we understanding what we're talking about here? Good, that gives you a bit of a picture. Now, having said that, what evidence does the Christian religion offer as reasons to believe that God exists? Now, we talked about creation and evolution. We leave that alone for the moment. To have faith in the Bible, that the Bible is God's inspired word, that Jesus Christ, as the divine Son of God, the divine Son of God. That's a big ask. It really is a big ask to believe that God became man and that he was the Son of God. Has Jesus fulfilled Old Testament prophecies of the Christ? We'll certainly look at that in coming presentation. But today particularly about Jesus Christ as the divine Son of God. Let's face it. The Bible claims that the God of the Bible exists. Marvelous the way the Bible begins. God is not setting out why he exists. He just introduces himself as the creator of everything that there is. And so, the Bible claims, and God said it many times, he is the only one. He is the only one. You know the Shema for the Jews, you know what it is. They say that very regularly. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one, a God. Not referring to the personalities. Although it's one personality, but three persons. But we have the concept here that there is only one true God. That's it. And the Bible claims that Jesus is God's Son. And again, that's the topic for today. Let me go back in time some few thousand years. Have a look. This, what you're looking at, is the Pax Romana, the peace of Rome. Well, it was anything but peaceful. If you look at everything here, all the way from England, look at the major portions of Europe down here. Not too much on this side of the Danube. They didn't go much into Russia. That's not because Vladimir Putin was there. It's simply they weren't interested. Then you have Turkey. I want you to remember this little area here, Bithynia, okay? Then you have Syria, so much trouble there. Then you have, of course, Palestine, Egypt, and Northern Africa, and that's all desert. And who wants to own a lot of desert? So that empire, at its heyday, as it is expressed there, pretty well ruled the then known world for some 600 years. That's quite a long time. Dominated. Of course you had people, of course, in China. They had major dynasties there and multitudes of people in South America, sure. But that was to them, for the Semitic people particularly, that was the whole world, you understand. That is how they looked at it. Now, when we look at where we have our major interest, of course, it is right here, and you can see why. Do you know that God got Abram, and he got him to go up, and then he came down into the land of Canaan, Palestine, another name for it. It's interesting, you can see, can't you? You can see here that this continent, Africa, is connected with the other continents like Asia and like Europe. That's the land corridor, you understand? Israel was right, it was really a hot spot. The major movements of powers always went through that corridor. Yeah? You with me? It's a very strategic location. God on purpose sent Abram to that territory. So when we look at this and we look at the days of Jesus, now you recognize the names. This is Judea. That is Samaria. And then you get Galilee. Galilee was a mixture of Jews and Gentiles. You know, not highly regarded by the Jews. The Decapolis means 10 cities. A lot of retirees of the Roman army used to set up house there. You have the River Jordan, that ravine here really, that runs into the Dead Sea. You recognize Bethlehem when Jesus was born, Jerusalem, and of course another place of tremendous interest, of course, as far as the person of Jesus is concerned, is Nazareth, where he grew up. Capernaum would have been more on the right on the Sea of Galilee, and then you have places like Bethsaida, and here you have Phoenicia. Jesus did go no further than Israel and some of the Phoenician territories. He was not well traveled. That's interesting. He never went terribly far. Very interesting. Now, we go to have a look at this. World population estimated, and it would be fairly accurate, would have been only 300 million. 2,000 years ago, it would have been only about 300 million. That appears to be the best estimates. A vast difference of the 7 billion we have today, isn't it? It's quite amazing, what a difference. It's good to know that, it's good to know that. There are five sources that I will be relying on as far as extra-biblical information is concerned. I'd like you to look at this man, the Publius Cornelius Tacitus. That is when he lived. The best, highly regarded, respected historian, Roman historian, was Tacitus. He was accurate. He was very adverse in his approach and feelings on Christianity. He didn't think much of it. He looked down upon it and he actually disliked it. But we're going to use some of his writings to prove that there was a historical Jesus. And much of what is taught in the Bible is recognized in secular history. And he's a good source. The second one is Pliny the Younger. Remember that I just pointed out to you that area called Bithynia. Remember that? There in Turkey. Well, he was the governor. He was a magistrate for a long time. Well-liked by his emperor Trajan. Or Trajan. He was a good friend of Tacitus. They really liked each other. He was an honest man, and so some of his writings can be very helpful for pursuing the evidence of the historical Jesus as well. And then there is Lucian of Samosata. Only a little bit of snip of information, but nevertheless very significant. He is what you would call a satirist. You know what a satirist is? It's a particular genre of literature that takes the mickey out of everybody, politicians, clergy. The intent is not just to score points on a person that can't defend himself. It is really meant to change them. So he was a very bright and very intelligent man, Lucian of Samosata. So we'll have a look at some of his writing. The one that you all probably know is Titus Flavius Josephus. You've all heard of him? You with me still? You've all heard of him. Now look at his names. Titus, that's Roman. Flavius. Flavius is actually the family name of Vespasian. There's an interesting story about him, just a little bit about the man. The man came from a priestly descent. Mom was fairly high up in the Jewish, what shall I say, population as well. He became a general for the Jews, and he led a revolt against the Romans, and the Romans came under a general by the name of Vespasian. And in 67 AD, they took him prisoner. And he would have been executed, crucified, or otherwise, if it weren't for the fact that he made a prediction, and Vespasian heard about it, that Vespasian would become the emperor. And not long after, unlikely, Vespasian became the emperor. Which is very interesting. And Vespasian was interested in that man that predicted that. And he learned that this man was a prolific historian. And he fascinated him. He took a mission to Rome, and he spared his life. And not only that, ultimately he so liked him, he set him free. And Josephus became very friendly with the son of Vespasian. Does anybody know what the name of the son of Vespasian was? I suppose I shouldn't really ask. Titus. Titus is the one who destroyed Jerusalem. Yeah, the Romans under Vespasian a few years later. Titus and him were very, very good friends. He was given Roman citizenship. And Flavius Josephus was a person who wanted to blend the Roman way of life with the Jewish way of life. He felt they could be compatible. He was the only one. No other Jew thought that they could. And so his writings are extremely well valued and reliable on this topic that we're going to talk about. The other one, the last source that I really like very much, is from a source, from a people who absolutely deny that Jesus had anything to do with deity. They reject the whole of the New Testament. Of course, that's the Jews. What we're going to look at is the Babylonian Talmud. There are two Talmuds, the Babylonian Talmud and the Jerusalem Talmud. The Babylonian one is more extensive. It was compiled from 70 AD to about 500 AD. The bulk of it from 70 to 200 AD. It is a compilation of information, everything about what is Jewish, the faith and practice, everything. The two main components are what is called the Mishnah, which is actually a compilation of rabbinical laws. And what is called the Gemaras. The Gemaras are actually the commentaries on those oral and written Mishnah statements. And a huge piece of work it is. It's quite incredible. Far more than the three books that are there. So that's the way of Jewish life. Now you understand that the Jews absolutely deny Jesus, that he, who he was, whom he said he was. And so, it is ironic, blessings from the Babylonian Talmud. Lovely. Because there's a blessing in it for us when we read it. Why? The harder they try to deny Jesus the true status that he deserved, the clearer the evidence becomes that Jesus was who he said he was. It's very fascinating. Let's go back to Cornelius Tacitus. This is what he said. He wrote in his annals there, and the man least credible is a very fine scholar, wrote the book, Case for Christ. He's a pastor, he's a Christian apologist. He wrote a letter to the effect or to the happenings of the persecution of the Christians in Rome during the time of Nero. Now, you've heard of Nero? Oh, he was a villain. The man was a pig, really. The way he lived and what he did. He was terrible. He was a shocker. There was an old part in Rome and he wanted to rebuild it. But he didn't have the heart to face the populace to knock it all down and redevelop it. You could say he was a developer. So what did he do? What would you do if you had premises? You would, you wanted to get rid of, and the tenants were stopping you.
Burn it down.
Yeah, burn it down. That's exactly what you were there, were you? No, I'm kidding. No, that's what he did. He started a fire. He started a fire. You know, that reminds me of a talk of two Jewish gentlemen. They were businessmen and they were retired. And this came to mind, that they never retired, you see. Sam and Mose. And so Sam sees Mose and he says, Mose, how are you? He said, oh, very good. How's work? No more work. What happened? Oh, I had a fire. Can you sugar? Oh, yeah, so he has. Why work? And so Moses says to Sam, he says, oh, how is your work? Said, work? No. He said, what happened to you? Oh, had a flood. A flood? Yes, a flood. Insured? Yeah, insured. Oh, good. Why good? And there's a moment of silence. And Moses says to Sam, now listen, a fire, I know. How do you start one of those? How do you start the flood? Got the picture? Now, you know, I thought it was funny. You obviously didn't. Now, he started this fire and he blamed the Christians. Nero fastened the guilt on the Christians. And so, on a class hated for their abominations, to the Romans they were so objectionable. They were called Christians by the population. I want you to see what it says. Christus, from whom the name had its origin, suffered the extreme penalty during the reign of Tiberius. Now it's interesting. Under whose reign was Jesus crucified? Tiberius. That's true. Have a look at this. At the hands of Pontius Pilate, who had his governorship, which he hated, in Judea from 26 to 36 AD. And he only served under one emperor, Tiberius Caesar. And one day I'm going to show you from the book of Daniel, the 11th chapter, it was predicted this time. 560 years before the event. And so, Christus, well, Christos is the Greek. Christus is more the Latin. Christ is the abbreviated form. Who do we mean? And what does Christ mean, by the way? What does Christ, Christus mean? Christos in the Greek. Anointed. The Hebrew word is Messiah or Messiah. From where we get the word Messiah. From asaf to anoint. Yeah? Now, it's interesting that we Christians, we named after Christ, correct?
Yes.
Right. He's just saying what is true. He suffered the extreme penalty. Now, can you guess what the extreme penalty was as far as the Romans were concerned? Oh, only one thing. There was one murderous torture that stood out from all other forms of execution, and that was the one. The extreme penalty was the crucifixion. Right. Now, he says, and a most mischievous superstition, that is the Christian belief, thus checked for the moment, because they were persecuted. They were executed. They were, terrible things, the Colosseums for the entertainment of the masses. They strove for the wild animals and other terrible things that they did to them. It's just absolutely shocking. But then again, Christianity broke out again, not only in Judea, the first source of evil. Isn't that interesting? As far as the Romans were concerned, it came from Judea. Why? Well, they were confronted with it when the Jews brought Jesus to Pilate. And that's the first time. They got in touch with it. And so, historically, it is correct. It started in Judea, as far as they were concerned. It started there, and it came back to Rome again. So we have a confirmation of an historical figure. And he had followers, and these followers were named after him. Correct? That's exactly right. He said they're even back in Rome. By the time he wrote this, it would have been probably, I think that letter was dated in 112 AD, the one that this extract is a part of. They came back again. They came back again. Now we go to Pliny the Younger, the governor of Bithynia. That's the translator who did a marvelous job. It's referred to as Epistola X96. He wrote quite a few letters. He wrote a very long letter to his emperor Trajan because he didn't quite know how to address the problem of the Christians. You know what the problem was there in Bithynia, there in Turkey, Asia Minor? The problem was there were so many Christians. How do you stop it? Then he talks about them in his letter to this emperor. He said, you know, they were in the habit of meeting on a certain fixed day before it was light. Now, are you familiar with Christians coming together on a certain fixed day? Yeah? Of course you are. They came on the Sabbath together. But apparently they had a very early service. And of course there was some reason for that, because it wasn't well appreciated by the Romans. And so what happened is, before it was light, and when they sung in alternate verses a hymn to whom? To Christ. In other words, this Christ they singing to. They are singing to. He said, as to a God. So, we have from secular sources that there was a person identified as Christ, Christus, whatever you like to call him, the anointed one, who was a man, and then they began to worship him as a God. You understand? And this is quite different. Whilst the Romans, some of the Roman emperors, saw themselves as semi-deities, they did. They wanted incense burned to them. But I don't think that any of them ever believed they were really a God. But here you have a confirmation of a man, his followers named after him, who actually was crucified, but he was worshipped by his followers as a God. Yeah? Bound themselves by a solemn oath. I like this too. Not to do any wicked deeds, but never to commit any fraud, theft, or adultery, never to falsify their words, nor deny a trust when they should be called upon to deliver it. That sounds to me a summary of the commandments. So the early church kept, obviously, what? The commandments of God. True? This is just apostolic or just past apostolic church. They were keeping the commandments of God, including meeting on a fixed day. And that would have had to have been the Sabbath day. After which, their meetings, it was their custom to separate. So they meet early before daylight on the Sabbath morning, then they separate and they reassemble to partake of food. Now, the food of an ordinary kind and of an innocent kind. It wasn't a gluttony, a feast, and a jug like the Romans used to do. They used to do a lot of this too. Not these people. These people apparently had a simple and wholesome food. It was the company that they were looking for. And that's a wonderful habit. We do a little bit of that after this service as well, a bit later, but there it is. Now, Lucian of Samosata. Interesting. These are two brothers. They're both English scholars. And they work on this particular one, the translation from Latin, the death of Peregrina. Both together. The Christians worship a man, he says, they worship a man to this day. So a man is worshipped. The distinguished personage who introduced their novel rites, that is the way they should live. Is that what Jesus taught? Jesus taught how to live, right? He commanded them to love one another. Right? He says he was crucified on that account. Jesus was crucified on what he taught. Now, there were many false accusations. Get me, don't misunderstand me. But basically, what he taught was so just, it annoyed the authorities, those who were in charge, because they could see they were exposed. They hated him for it, as much as Cain hated Abel for showing him up for doing it wrong. You understand? And he was crucified on that account. It was impressed upon them. It was impressed upon them by that original lawgiver. I like that statement. Because really, Jesus, when he was alive, he only reiterated the very law that he gave at Mount Sinai. In fact, the Ten Commandments had been there from the beginning, straight after the fall, really. Not as succinctly formulated anywhere recorded, but they were there. Cain knew he shouldn't have killed his brother. And adultery would have been out of the question too. And all the other stealing, etc., and lying. It was impressed upon them by their original lawgiver that they are all brothers from the moment they were converted. They became brothers. We talk about the Christian community here, most definitely. They denied the gods of the Greeks, because the Roman gods were just Greek gods with a different name. That's basically the truth. And so he said they denied the gods of Greece and worshipped the crucified charge or personality. They were worshipping a man who was crucified, who taught them, and the teachings that he taught led to his rejection and crucifixion. Are you all following me so far? This comes right from outside the Bible. This is not a fairy tale or a make-believe. This is all recognized, accepted, scholarly translated, hardcore evidence that there was such a person. No question about it. No question about it. Now, and live after his laws. They were a commandment-keeping people. I like that little snippet. Apparently, the notion that all the commandments were done away with at the cross is just a notion, but not a reality. The apostolic church and the immediate after lived according to the commandments. They did. Titus Flavius Josephus. You know, Josephus was there, but in 70 AD, Jerusalem was destroyed by the Romans under Titus, where 1 million Jews were slaughtered. 97,000 of them were taken as prisoners to die a miserable abuse and death anywhere else. In fact, Titus employed Josephus. He employed Josephus to go into Jerusalem and try to tell the people to surrender to the Romans. Titus did not want to destroy Jerusalem. Titus did certainly he did not want to destroy the temple. He had given his officers strict instructions not to destroy the temple. But in the heat of the battle, then finally, after an extended time, they reached the northern side, and the soldiers poured through, and the Jews were withdrawing there on the actual Temple Mount. His soldiers were in such a rage, they were unstoppable. The blood was streaming down the steps. It was incredible. It was incredible, the wholesale slaughter. And even his parents, of Flavius Josephus, died in that scene. When he was pleading with the Jews to surrender, he had to run for his life. They saw him as a traitor. He had to run for his life, and he just made it out of the city. Terrible thing that happened to the destruction of Jerusalem. On two occasions in his Jewish antiquities, there are two major words, that is the antiquities of the Jews, and the other one is the Jewish wars. On two occasions in his Jewish antiquities, he mentions Jesus. In fact, this is the second one. The second less revealing reference describes the condemnation of one James by the Jewish Sanhedrin. It's interesting. He says this James, says Josephus, was the brother of Jesus, the so-called Christ. There he mentions it. Now, he was not, of course, anywhere near a follower of Christ. But I'm telling you, he's saying he was there. He's also saying that he had a brother by the name of James. And that is true. That is true. That is absolutely true. Jesus, the so-called Christ. He didn't believe in it, but that's the Christ, you know. He said, a quote from Paul in the letter to the Galatians. But other of the apostles saw a man named James, the Lord's brother. See, here we have it. Paul affirms that the Lord had a brother by the name of James. There it is. This is when he came back after 3 years having been to Saudi Arabia. And when he came back, he met some of the apostles, or actually only Peter, but none of the others, but James, the Lord's brother, he met. It's interesting. Snippet of information, but a confirmation of the correctness of the Bible. This testimony, Flavian, about this time, he records on the life of Jesus, about this time that lived Jesus. I want you to see how he speaks about him. Have a good look. A wise man, if indeed one ought to call him a man. Now that's very peculiar, isn't it? This is a non-believer. He says, you know, you wonder whether we're talking about just a man here. He says, because he brought about surprising feats, meaning miracles. He says, there was a man by the name of Jesus who did wonderful miracles to the point that you could not really just call him a man, correct? That's quite an admission. That is quite an admission. And so, he was the Christ. Well, he's only recording what they saw in him, you know, and you understand. He was not a believer. He had a very different doctrine in his mind. He said he was the Christ. He considered this. When Pilate condemned him to be crucified. Now, we know that that is an historical fact because the Bible records it, correct? Here you are, confirmation of the Bible once again. He says, when Pilate condemned him to be crucified, those who had come to love him, that's his followers, did not give up their affection for him. And that's true. I think the love for Jesus increased even amongst his disciples when Jesus went back. Sometimes when someone is gone, you miss them, don't you? And so, on the third day, he appeared restored to life. He's only recording what he has heard. Now, this is interesting. The Bible teaches that Jesus rose, what? On the third day, absolutely. And the tribe of Christians, tribe? Well, all right, if he has to. And the tribe of Christians has not disappeared. He would have written this late 1st century AD. Decades after, Jesus would have gone back to heaven. He said the Christians have not disappeared. They're there. And we know that the Bible teaches that. Go to the book of Acts and all the other epistles that follow. Now let's go to the Babylonian Talmud. The Babylonian Talmud is a fascinating source of information. Talking about Jesus. They're talking about Jesus. They have given him the name Yeshua, which is the briefer form for Yeshua, which is his Aramaic name. Yehoshua is the Hebrew name. God saves, that's what it means. Or God will save. On the eve of the Passover. Now, the Passover was for a week. And the eve of the Passover, they would make a sacrifice called the Passover lamb, right? That day was the 14th of Nisan, which is the first month of the religious Jewish calendar. So we're talking about a confirmation that Jesus was hanged, and I'm going to come to that, on the 14th of Nisan, which is really the eve of the Passover. Does everybody understand that? The Bible teaches it. I want you to have a look at that term hanged. People say, oh, but he said he was hanged. No, no, it's the same thing as crucifixion, I'll show you. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. That's what Paul wrote in his letter to the Galatians. Have a careful look. Being made a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone that hangs on a tree. So he's talking about Christ hanging on a tree. Why? Well, what was the cross made of? Wood. Wood. Do you understand the significance of that? What is wood standing for? What does wood stand for in biblical symbolic language? Humanity. Humanity. Always remember that. You know, God became incarnate. He became one with mankind. And the crucifixion absolutely nailed the message that the Roman soldiers never meant to give to the world, or for that matter to the universe. You can't get closer to wood, to timber, than being nailed to it. Correct? He became one with humanity. Crucifixion, as cruel as it was an appropriate expression of his very mission. Do you know the Romans were acting out the gospel? They didn't even know it. They didn't even know it. Jesus had a trade. What was it? What is a carpenter work is? No, he still does. He's still a carpenter. As our heavenly high priest. You know, the symbolism is fantastic, and we'll talk more about it in other presentations. The fact, a confirmation from the Babylonian Talmud, the opposers of Jesus, the one who reject the New Testament, they are affirming exactly what the New Testament is teaching. Now, let's go back. Here's another one from Luke. Then one of the criminals who were hanged blasphemed him, saying, etc., if you are the Christ, save yourself and us. See, the expression you find twice. Once in the Gospel of Luke, once in the letter to the Galatians by the Apostle Paul. Can you see that? Okay. Good. For 40 days, this is the Jews speaking, the Talmud. For 40 days before the execution took place, a herald cried, he is going forth to be what? Isn't that interesting? Two verses. Well, first one, with the intent of executing Jesus, how many days before they arrested him and crucified, executed him? How many days? Not even. Because the day starts at sunset. Thursday night, sunset. About midnight, he's arrested. 3 o'clock in the afternoon of Friday, same day, he's executed. And suffers immense treatment, brutality before that. That supposed to have happened. The Jewish law, the halacha, if you study the Talmud, the Jewish law, the halacha, is based on mercy. And I know I've spoken on Jewish law, and I'll do it another time again. They violated every principle, every rule of their laws. Every one of them. There was supposed to be an announcement. They were supposed to wreck their brains, how they may find a way to save the life of one of the sons of Israel. And they didn't do it. They were hell-bent on getting him out of the way as fast as they could. And they were in a hurry. They even got Pilate out of bed well before the alarm clock went off. And he was very cranky about that. So, They were so much in a hurry because why? The Passover, I want you to remember this, is a very holy feast. And that holy is, you have to be very holy, not to be defiled. Okay? And that's going to help you in a minute. There is another statement. He is going forth to be stoned. Why stoned? Well, what was the Jewish way of execution? Stoning. But it wasn't the Jewish way. Because he has practiced sorcery and enticed Israel to apostasy. Isn't that interesting? These were the charges that were brought to Jesus by whom? The chief priests and the elders. Have a look. When the Pharisees heard it, they said, Matthew 12, verse 24, this fellow does not cast out demons except by Beelzebub, the ruler of the demons. Who is Beelzebub? Satan. Actually, literally translated by Baal is Lord, but it's the Lord of the flies. Who wants to be a Lord of the flies? But there it is. What are they accusing him of? Sorcery. That is sorcery. That recorded in the Bible is recorded in secular writing exactly as the Bible says it happened. Exactly like that. And they began to accuse him, saying, we found this fellow perverting the nation. What's another word for perverting? Apostasy. Isn't that what they said? The Bible says that's what they said. And all that the Babylonian Talmud has done is record exactly what the New Testament is saying. Verifying the veracity of the New Testament. That is exactly what happened. He stirs up the people, they said, in the fifth verse of the same chapter. He stirs up the people, teaching throughout all Judea, beginning from Galilee to this place. They said, that is what he's doing. He's stirring up the people. Apostasy, you see. That was the chance. Now we're looking at what's called Toledot Yeshu. Toledot means really generations, but it also means an account of events. So we're looking at the accounts of events. It gets really tasty. Now I want you to concentrate. It's nice and cool in here. You want it a bit cooler? Okay. It relates that his disciples plan to what? Out there. They say the disciples were going to steal the body. Now do you remember what happened? Where was Jesus buried? Yeah, in the garden in of Joseph of Arimathea. His grave. Do you recall that the Bible says there was a Roman guard all around it? Do you think the disciples who had done a runner in Gethsemane, when they saw Jesus being bound, they ran for their life? Nobody was persecuting them. But they ran away. They were scared. Do you think they had the bottle to go to their graveside and challenge a Roman guard? Oh, it'd be the last thing you would do. They were hiding. They were hiding in the same upper room where they had the Passover meal. They were hiding. They were scared. So it relates to his disciples plan to steal his body. Now that's a third thing. Matthew 28. When they had assembled with the elders and consulted together, they gave a large sum of money to the soldiers. Which soldiers? Well, the ones that were supposed to guard the grave. The Romans. Roman guard. Isn't that interesting? Saying, tell them, His disciples came at night and stole him away whilst we... Now listen, there are certain things you never confess. And as a Roman soldier on guard duty, you will never confess that you fell asleep. Because That goes, you understand? That was the standard penalty. So what is the point of, why did the Roman guards, Bible teaches, why did the Roman guard run away? They were scared. They were frightened to death. Why were they so scared? Yeah, one angel turned up. A big one. It was a bit slow putting the brakes on. There was an earthquake. Lightning. And those soldiers, the moment they had enough collection to get up, they were running as fast as the little legs could carry them. They were intercepted, and the priest said to them, hold on, what's happening? They told them the story. And you know what? They believed it. That's why they gave him a lot of money. Now, what is the point of getting a lot of money and you're going to be executed because you fell asleep on the job? I mean, really? They said, and this comes, if this comes to the governor's ears, we will appease him and make you secure. In other words, we will talk to Pontius Pilate, the Roman procurator. We'll talk to him. And they did. In the book Desire of Ages, Pilate wanted to talk to them. And he did. And he had one look at their faces. And Pilate knew. And Pilate knew what they said was true. And he never had a good night's sleep after. It followed him, it haunted him till the day he committed suicide. Some years later. He did. Now, so here we have an interesting thing. The Talmud says the disciples stole the body, which is exactly a story they concocted. Do you understand? You would expect it to be in the Talmud. Correct? Of course you would. And so, however, a gardener, oh, that's interesting, named Judah. Now, Judas and Judah are the same name. Judah means God is praised. Well, Judas didn't quite do that. It's interesting that they had to pick a name, and they picked the name Judas. That's interesting. I'll tell you in a minute why they did that. A gardener named Judas discovered the plans of the disciples to steal the body. You know, once you begin to lie, you have to be very good. You have a good memory, and you top them up with another lie. True? And he dug a new grave in the garden, because the grave that Jesus was in was, of course, a cavity in the rock. That was the half-decent or the prestigious way, if you like, to be buried. Do you understand that? That's how they used to do it. Remember when Jesus died, there was an earthquake as well, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, that Friday afternoon. It's interesting that he was on the cross at 9 a.m. Some 6 hours later he dies. It's about 3 p.m. There's an earthquake, and many of the bodies of the saints were thrown out. You find it in the book of Matthew. Find it yourself. It's interesting. Because they were in the rocks, and it split the rocks. You understand? There must have been some earthquake. However, a gardener named Judah discovered that place, dug a new grave in his garden. Then he removed Jesus' body from Joseph's tomb. Oh, that's nice. Joseph's tomb. What does the Bible say the name of the man was in whose tomb Jesus was going to be buried? Joseph of Arimathea. That's good. They've got that right. The name anyway. Then he, Judas, removed Jesus' body from... He couldn't have. Judas died before Jesus was executed. He couldn't have. But still, as I said, once you begin with... Yeah, you have to keep going. And he placed it in his own dark grave. It gets absolutely absolutely fantastic sometimes. That's what they say. This is official belief in the Talmud. The disciples came to the original tomb, which is Joseph's tomb, found Jesus' body gone. Is that true? Yeah, but ultimately they had the courage to go there. They found it empty. The women were there before them. And they proclaimed him risen. Now, not on the basis that there was an empty tomb. It was on the basis that Jesus, on the third day, appeared to them again on the Sunday. You understand? And then they proclaimed him risen. You with me? So they true, they did proclaim Jesus risen. No doubt about it, but not the way they talked about it. The Jewish leader also proceeded to Joseph's tomb and found it empty. So they agreed there was an empty grave. Judah then took him to his grave, the one he dug in the ground, dug up the body of Jesus, and it really gets good now, the Jewish leaders were greatly relieved. Oh, he's dead, he's not risen. Isn't it good? Cool. They were very relieved. And they wanted to take the body of Jesus, according to the Talmud. But Judah replied that he would sell the body of Jesus. Guess how much the Talmud said they paid for the body of Jesus? Oh, you guessed it in one. And he did do so for 30 pieces of silver. He did sell Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. But hey, when he was alive, it was for the betrayal. I'm just saying. The one of the 12, now from Matthew 26, called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priest and said, "What are you willing to give me if I deliver him up to you?" And you guessed it, they counted out to him 30 pieces of silver, which is the price of a slave of the day. That's it. Can you see what's happening here? Sometimes if you want to deny Jesus, you just have to choose to be so determined to do so. Why would you do that if the facts all point the other way? I can't understand that. The Jewish priest then dragged, this is the last comment. The Jewish priest then dragged Jesus' body through the streets of Jerusalem. Now we have just gone right over the top. We're up with the Pharisees somewhere. Because this is the Passover week, the most holy week on the religious Jewish calendar. To defile the streets of Jerusalem, when people from everywhere has come together, all the Jews have come together to drag a dead body through the street and defile the streets of their holy city, you must be kidding. They would never do that. And here's the question. It begs the question. If that is true, how successful do you think that the apostles would have been in proclaiming him risen and attracting followers to Christ? If you saw his dead body a few weeks before through the streets, 50 days later, no matter what happens, you're not going to believe that he's risen and alive. They would have had no followers. And the disciples, which became the apostles, would not for 1 minute have entertained the notion that they would proclaim the gospel truth as it is in Jesus, expecting to pay with their lives for that. Come on, this is not realistic. But there it is. There it is. So, did Jesus exist? Yes, he most certainly did. That's the good news. You want better news than good news? Here it is. He still does. He's still alive. Of course he is. Of course he is. There always will be haters. You know, they hate what you believe. They hate God, hate religion, all the same thing. There always will be doctors. There always will be doubters. It's like weed. They grow everywhere. There always will be doubters. There will be non-believers. Those who decide, no, I am not buying. no matter what evidence you present. Then, of course, that will be you. Don't you ever get annoyed, and you mustn't be, that people just keep on rejecting? Well, here's a thought. I'm not sure whether it's a good thought, but it's a thought. One day you'll prove them wrong. Does that help? Does that help? If you ever feel that someone has absolutely ridiculed, or, you know, people can do that, they're cruel. One day, they're wrong. And they know it. And you know it. There was a Christ. Of course there was. There was a crown of thorns, there was a wooden cross, there was Gethsemane, there was Calvary, and they, whatever the New Testament tells you, secular history tells you, the facts, he was there and it happened. Exactly as the Bible teaches. I want you to understand, if there was one call coming from Calvary's Hill, it is this call, you keep the faith. You understand? Because you have absolute reason to believe everything that the Word of God, the New Testament included, is telling you. And so, I was listening to some YouTube, and I forgot the names of these guys, I was going to remember. They sang a song about doubters, and I think the album is called The Eternal Doubters, and I sort of like the lyrics. I want to tell you the story of a young man by the name of Shamita Yapa, and he was normally known as Sam. Sam came from Sri Lanka and he came to America. And that was his dream. Go to America and study. So finally it all was organized and he got to America and he began his study and things went perfect. He swatted in just beautiful. He made friends. You know, he got a bit of a part-time job and he got a girlfriend, nice one too. He got a girlfriend and his marks, you know, in his junior years of college, he was doing well and the sun was shining. Everything was well. And then one day, things turned around. Lost that job, ran out of money. Girlfriend broke up. I don't know whether it had anything to do with the lack of money, obviously. I don't know. His marks were going down, and in fact, he was getting terribly depressed. Very depressed. And one day, he was so down and out in the library. He was sitting there, the library of the university, and he was contemplating not only what his situation was, not only the fact he could never go back home to his parents, he could never go back to Sri Lanka and face his family as a failure. Couldn't do that. Do you know, he contemplated to kill himself. He records the story. He said, my contemplation at that dark afternoon, my contemplation was, how do I kill myself? Terrible, when you come to that. And then something happens, and you can accept it or reject it. He accepted it. You know, he heard a voice. He heard a voice, and the voice says, have you ever asked me for help? And he looked around. And there was nobody. And he thought he'd gone crazy. Then he thought he imagined it. And the voice came back. I am Jesus. And I'm right here. Next to you. This guy, all the time that he was there, had ridiculed the Christian belief. He had annoyed and plagued his biophysics professor, who was a Christian, and tried to And he tried, he studied the Bible. Do you know he had read the Bible for one purpose? He had read the Bible. He had read the Bible just so he could talk other Christians out of their silly belief. Do you understand that? And he'd taken pride. He'd taken pride in being successful. He took pride in his achievements. I mean, he was looking good. Until it all went wrong. And he particularly felt the need to talk to someone. Sometimes you just want to talk to someone. Yeah? And he thought of his professor in biochemics. And he said, I got out of that library and I ran across the grass there, and he ran up to the stairs, ran up to the office of the professor. He threw the door open, he never knocked on the door. And the professor looked at him and he said, I've always hoped and prayed for this moment. Sit down. So he sat down. And they talked for hours. You see, in the library, he had felt the presence of Jesus. And as a denier of Jesus, he had realized, maybe like Paul of old, he'd been fighting the wrong fight. You ever fight the wrong fight? Give it up. It's true. Look at it. Have you ever asked me for help? If Jesus was standing here today and you had doubts about him, still he would say to you, have you ever asked me for help? Because I'm right here. Me, right there, next to you. That is still true. So it'd be good to ask him, wouldn't it? I think we should. With whatever we need. I love this story. This statement comes from Mother Teresa. You want to have a good look at this statement? You will never know Jesus is all you need until Jesus is all you have. Get the picture? That happened to Sam. Lost everything. Lost everything. There it was. Jesus. Right there. I think that's beautiful. I love this story. I love this story. You'll never know Jesus is all you need until Jesus is all you have. Yeah? We have a special item. Yes, sweet.
The sound of your name. Thank you for the beautiful item. Shall we bow our heads? Heavenly Father, we've spoken about your word and we've looked at your word and we've looked outside your word. We thank you also for the historical evidence that you've seen fit to allow us to have. And so we thank you for that, and we want to say to you that we really would like to so believe in you that we recognize all we need is Jesus. Anything else, so important may seem to be, if we have Jesus, we have the promise. We have the surety. And one day, soon, we will see you. That will be so good to finally really, really, really see you. Thank you for that promise. Thank you for everything that you are. Good, forgiving, kind, patient, long-suffering. Thank you for all of the above. And help us to ask Jesus for help. Because we need it. So Lord, I ask the blessing as we leave from this room that we, as we have fellowship and we enjoy the refreshments that maybe bless, nourish our bodies. Thank you for the life that you have given us so far. Thank you for making yourself known to us. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful week. And we'll see you next week again. Part 2 of the empirical evidence of the historical Jesus.